Spencer Lee. Spencer Lee, Spencer Lee, Spencer Lee is the man for me.
Welcome to On The Beat, which now runs at its new time of 6:30 until 8 o'clock. Today's show is pretty well devoted to an interview with the late, great Rory Gallagher. And let's kick off with one of his great tracks, Rory Gallagher and Shadow Play. Well, that's telepathy for you. I meant to open the show with Rory Gallagher and Shadow Play, and I put on another track from the LP by accident, which is his tribute, I suppose, to the Violent Men of Football, because it's actually called Shin Kicker. So amazing, actually, that that happened. Anyway, Rory Gallagher was born in Ballyshannon, County Donegal, on the 2nd of March 1949, and he died in a London hospital on the 14th of June this year after complications stemming from a liver transplant. He came to fame as part of Taste in the 1960s and then had major success at the Isle of Wight Festival in 1970. Now, he's the guy that has the image of the battered Stratocaster, the frayed checkered work shirt and the flying locks of hair. And of course, that's now a rock and roll cliché. But I think, and you can correct me on this, I think that Rory Gallagher actually started that. I met up with Rory Gallagher at the Royal Court a few years before his death, and this interview has never been broadcast in full. When I met Rory, I first asked him how common it was for a performer to be managed by his brother.
Not that common. I mean, you get sort of brothers working together in different bands. It's handy, though, because it doesn't have to become a big business deal then. I mean, obviously, you've got to be professional, but, you know, he's worked with me since the start, really, so it's very handy, you know, I'm lucky in that respect, you know.
It must be very good because you know your brother's not going to rip you off, and you hear so many dreadful tales about managers, so it must give you a great security.
Oh, indeed. Well, I've been through the mill with a few characters early on, so it's a comforting fact, you know.
Of course, you were born in Ireland, and Ireland is a very famous for its music, and its folk music in particular.
Yeah.
Do you think that has influenced you in any way?
One of my parents played Irish traditional, and at home I listened to everyone from Dead Donnan to Clannad to Chieftains to Ronnie Drew and company. It affects me chord-wise and certain song ideas, but I don't start from Irish folk roots, really. I start from blues roots and work from there. But, you know, you can't keep out a strong tradition like that out of your music, you know. The Irish stuff, I mean, you know.
Now, presumably, when you were growing up, it was rock and roll and skiffle as such, mm-hmm. So your liking for the blues must have come a bit later, because kids, say, of 12 years old don't say, I like the blues, do they?
In my case, once I heard that Lonnie Donegan was doing Woody Guthrie songs, and then I noticed he was doing Leadbelly songs, a Stewie Leadbetter, and I went and checked out some of his things, and all those songs like The Rock Island Line, Bring a Little Water, Sylvie. So it's not too far then from Leadbelly to Big Bill Brunsey. And of course then in the 60s growing up, you'd be listening to Jimmy Reed and Chuck Berry, the R&B people, and you discover Muddy Waters bit by bit. But like, obviously you don't, you know, I didn't grow up with blues records laying around the house. I had to kind of go out and discover them for myself and read up on them. You know, as you're growing up, you don't specialize, you listen to one thing, you listen to rock and roll, folk, blues, whatever, and just distill it all. But as the years went by, I got more and more, you know, committed to the blues thing, even though I write my own material, which borders into hard rock and other things. But the soul of the music is blues, I think, from what we do.
If you got money in the bank, don't let your woman draw it out, 'cause she'll take all your money and then she'll kick you out. I once had money in a fast Cadillac car, but I made a big mistake, let my baby know where they are. Then she took all my possessions and then she threw me out. Now, young man, heed my advice. I'll tell you once, I mean I'll tell you twice. Keep an eye on your old lady anytime that she goes stepping out.
Oh, woman that I hate more. You know who that is? Why, that's my mother-in-law. My baby's pretty fast, but her mother's even faster on the draw.
A lot of people who aren't really into the blues would say, oh, this is boring music, it's so repetitive. How do you answer that charge?
Well, it is repetitive, but I mean, that's just part of the charm of it in a roundabout way. But then, I mean, Hendrix was basically a blues player. I mean, and recently you've got Robert Cray, the Fabulous Thunderbirds, Stevie Ray Vaughan. I mean, rock and roll is repetitive. I mean, rock and roll is only a manic version of blues. I mean, so if you like rock and roll, you should like blues. There again, I can imagine some people finding the country blues and things like that a little bit too ethnic for them, too rough and ready, you know.
Can you give a good example of a country blues that we can put in? About what do you mean by country blues as opposed to blues?
Well, you could treat Chicago blues as electric blues, broadly speaking. That means like Howlin' Wolf, the Muddy Waters Band, Elmore James. These are guys who plugged their guitars in and took a stage away from the country. The country blues would be like people who were primarily acoustic players and didn't always play with drums and bass and so on. That's not a very good answer now, but I mean, it's basically traditional players from the different states, from rural areas. They usually played on their own, as a rule. But then when all these people migrated north into Chicago and Detroit, you know, they became city folks, and bit by bit, in those places, the bars they used to play, they couldn't be heard, so the next thing they got amps and plugged in, and it became another thing again, you know. Well, Blind Boy Fuller is one example, Blind Blake, Scrapper Blackwell, well, it goes on and on and on. I mean, Big Joe Williams would be country blues in a way, Bucker White. But some of these guys obviously bridge the gap as well, you know.
Where does someone like Jimmy Rogers fit in the picture?
Well, he was basically a country singer, as you know. He was a fine strummer, rhythm guitar player. And he supposedly stole the yodel from, well, the yodel's a country thing, but he did work with a lot with some blues artists, and that influenced him and vice versa. But then there was another Jimmy Rogers who played with the Muddy Waters band, who played second guitar with Muddy. And he's a great singer, and he's still alive. He made one great album way back when Muddy would finish his sessions. If there was time to spare in the studio, Muddy would let him do his couple of songs. So it goes on and on, you know.
You told me, baby, once upon a time, you said if I would be yours, you would sure be mine. That's all right. I know you don't love me no more, baby, but that's all right. I'll never be the same, but that's alright.